Okay, thanks a lot, Lewis, and thanks everybody for coming out tonight. Appreciate it. So basically the title pretty much says what I'm going to do. I'm going to give more or less three presentations in one. The first, I'm going to say a little bit about the latest science. I mean, you know, one could spend an hour or two just talking about, you know, climate science and what the evidence is. So I'm going to touch on some of the latest. I'm going to talk about why it's serious. And then finish up with what we can do about it. So I guess maybe the first two are sort of the doom and gloom part. And then, so don't leave just after the first two. Wait until you hear that there are some solutions. I like The Onion because it's got this sarcastic sense of humor. Report, global warming issue from 2 or 3 years ago may still be a problem. And so I would concur with that. I think it is, believe it or not, it may still be a problem. Okay, so part one, talk about the latest science, and then how do we know where the people that are causing the climate to change? So, you know, in school, when I was in college, I took fluid dynamics and atmospheric science, but my profession is really mechanical engineer, and most of my career has been solving heat transfer problems. And when you come down to just the fundamentals of climate change, it's basically a heat transfer problem. And here's the problem, is that basically the Earth wants to be in balance, heat transfer-wise, energy balance. And so what's coming in is solar radiation. We call that shortwave radiation. It's the stuff you can see with your eyes. And then it radiates, any object that's warm radiates out to space, all right? So this is, you know, you've seen our special forces. They wear, you know, special goggles that allow them to see infrared. It's not normally visible, but that's what the Earth radiates out. And those two want to be in balance. And they've been in balance for a long time until we started mucking around. The atmosphere has what are called greenhouse gases. What those do is they block the outgoing infrared radiation. They absorb it, okay? And so they cause the Earth to be warmer than it would be otherwise. And thank goodness there are naturally occurring greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, because if they weren't there, the Earth would be about 60 degrees Fahrenheit cooler, meaning on average, all the water would be frozen. So thank goodness we have greenhouse gases. The issue is that by burning fossil fuels, we've added greenhouse gases. And so what happens is, what happens when you add more of this blanket of greenhouse gas? It traps the infrared radiation, and the Earth is out of balance. How much is it out of balance? We know pretty much it's out of balance by about 3/4 of a watt for every square meter of surface area of the Earth. And so the difference between the solar energy coming in and the infrared radiation going out is about that. Now, that looks like a small number, 3/4 of a watt, but you have to multiply that by the surface area of the whole Earth, okay? And that's how much we're out of balance. And so the Earth wants to get back in balance. How is it doing that? It's warming up so it can radiate more infrared radiation away. The hotter an object is, the more infrared radiation. Now, what happens if you get what's called a runaway greenhouse effect? What happens if, and some of these are positive feedbacks, you know, for example, if you melt the ice, the ocean, the exposed ocean, if you melt sea ice, the exposed ocean absorbs more solar energy instead of reflecting it away. So there are certain things that, when the greenhouse effect occurs, there are certain things that can feed back and amplify it. So here's an example of a runaway greenhouse effect. Probably most of you remember from school that Venus is about a third of the way into the sun from the Earth. It's the second planet. Mercury is the planet that's closest to the sun. Mercury is not the hottest planet. Venus is the hottest planet. Why is it the hottest planet if it's not the closest one to the sun? It's because its atmosphere is almost 100% carbon dioxide. It's a runaway greenhouse system. Its surface temperature is 870 degrees Fahrenheit, enough to melt lead. This is what happens in the extreme if you let greenhouse gases run away. Okay, so what's happened on the Earth? There are various temperature plots by NOAA, but the British do this, the Japanese. This is data from the Goddard Institute for Space Studies. This is data that NASA takes. It's the data that I like the best. But if you lay all these data on top of each other, they all show very similar results. And what you can see is a general warming effect. You can see some periods in here where it levels out, you know, for 6 or 7 years or so. You can see here there's been a little bit of leveling. The three warmest years were 2005, 2010, and last year, 2014. But you can see there's been a little leveling in certain parts. That's due to a variety of things. The air, the atmosphere on the Earth is very, very thin and very, very fickle. So small volcanic eruptions block sunlight. They can cause cooling. Overturning in the ocean, bringing colder ocean water to the surface. We've seen a lot of La Niñas in recent years with cold water upwelling to the surface. That cools the air near the surface. So these various effects cause there to be a lot of noise in this signal. Now you can see that from 1940 to 1970, it had sort of flattened out. But in 1970, it really started going up again. Does anybody remember any key legislation that was passed in 1970 in the United States? Because the U.S., certainly at that time, was by far the biggest emitter of greenhouse gases in the world. The Clean Air Act was passed in 1970. So what happens is when you burn fossil fuels, two things happen. You put carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. That becomes a greenhouse gas blanket. It traps warmth. But at the same time, you put sulfur dioxide, these aerosols in the atmosphere that block sunlight. All right? We've seen the Chinese building lots of coal plants, putting a lot of air pollution in the air. That tends to mask global warming. So that's what was happening here. And then you could see the temperature going off again. But that's just the air. 90% of the heat goes into the oceans. Okay? The oceans hold much more heat than the atmosphere. And if you look at this plot, you can see how much of the heating is. And we have all sorts of measurements in the ocean now that are showing that the ocean is still warming like crazy. What about the ice? I have limited time. I'm not going to spend much time talking about sea ice. When we get into the question and answer period, we could talk about that. I'm talking here about land-based ice. Why? Because, you know, when sea ice melts, it doesn't contribute to sea level rise. If you have an ice cube floating in a drink, when you walk away from it, you don't have to worry that it's going to melt and the glass is going to overflow, because the weight of the ice cube, by Archimedes' principle, is already displacing that water volume. Land-based ice, when it melts, it flows into the oceans, it raises sea level. So it's the land-based ice that we're really worried about. And the major ice sheets are the Greenland ice sheet at the North Pole and all of Antarctica at the South Pole. NASA has some very clever ways to measure the mass of the ice at both poles. And these are plots showing what's been happening. The top curve is the mass of the all of Antarctica. The next one down is what's happened in Greenland, all right? And then you have the sum of the two. The point is, the ice caps at both poles of our planet are melting, and they're melting in an accelerating way. They're losing more and more ice every year. What's happening in Antarctica is very interesting. What happens there is warm ocean water is undermining what are called ice shelves. This is an ice shelf. It's sticking out, and it's more or less floating on the surface. It undermines it, and eventually, you've probably seen in the news, the Wilkins ice shelf and other ice shelves have broken off, some of them as big as the state of Rhode Island in one case, and they go off into the ocean. Again, they're already displacing water, but what happens is these ice shelves in Antarctica are like corks in a champagne bottle. They back up the glaciers, and so those glaciers move to the ocean much, much faster. This is an article, there a series of articles that appeared May 13th of last year. There were two different groups, one at the University of Washington and one from the Jet Propulsion Laboratory in Pasadena, that independently looked at the ice data from Antarctica. Both groups independently concluded the same thing. The West Antarctic ice sheet, not the East Antarctic ice sheet, but the West Antarctic ice sheet has lost so much in ice shelves that the glaciers are now going to move to the ocean unimpeded, and no matter what we do, we could stop burning all fossil fuels right now. They say the West Antarctic ice sheet is gone. We cannot recover it. Now, that means about 15 feet of sea level rise. That may take 200 or 300 years, that 15 feet, and you might say, well, you know, we don't care what happens 200 or 300 years from now. I think we should care about what happens to, but the point is, that's a huge change in the environment. And that's just with the temperature rising 0.8 degrees Celsius. That's how much we've raised it so far. You may have heard that scientists want to keep it below 2 degrees. That's something that was agreed to back in 1975. If scientists back then knew that at 8/10 of a degree C, we would irreversibly lose the West Antarctic ice sheet. There's no way they would have said, hey, 2 degrees is a safe limit. We know now it really isn't. So what's the culprit? You know, this is a balance of what's going on. This is what's happening on the land and the ocean. And these are fluxes of carbon dioxide. You know that what, you know, plants take in carbon dioxide. When they decay, they give off carbon dioxide. The ocean exchanges carbon dioxide with the atmosphere. So basically, these are pretty large fluxes. What we're adding is about 4% of that. Now, you may say, well, 4%, you know, and you've seen skeptics argue, wait a minute, what man puts in is tiny compared to the big fluxes that occur. That's a true statement. That's irrelevant. Why is it irrelevant? Because what we're doing is we're taking a system that was in balance for thousands of years and knocking it out of balance. Consider this. If your weight has been staying the same, what does it mean? It means that the amount of calories you're consuming are equal to the amount of calories you're burning. All right? Put that out of balance by 4%. What's going to happen? You're going to get fat. And what's happening is the atmosphere is getting fat on carbon dioxide. And we know that because we can measure it. So this is looking back at the ice core data. Drill that down into the ice, and we can measure the carbon dioxide content, and we can infer the temperature. They're very much in sync with each other. All right? They go up and down as we go in and out of these glacial periods. And basically, before we started burning fossil fuels, we were at about 280 parts per million. Now we're at 400 parts per million. This is an enormous sudden increase. It's unprecedented. You don't see anything in the geologic history with a spike like this, okay? And basically, if you talk to scientists that study that based on other measurements, they believe you have to go back at least 3 million years to find the carbon dioxide content this high. So this is huge, a big change, and it's a big sudden change. And we know this is from us, all right, because we can measure the ratio of carbon isotopes, carbon-14, carbon-12, in the carbon dioxide, and we know it's not natural. We know it came from burning old plants, namely fossil fuels. I've given talks on sort of giving a lot more detail about what we know, addressing skeptic arguments. I'm not going to do that today. I'm going to refer you instead just to one graphic. All these things here are the evidence, the fingerprints, the things that are happening to the climate that point to our addition of greenhouse gases. Every one of these things points to that. There's an excellent website called Skeptical Science. It's developed by a physicist in Queensland, Australia, John Cook. He's done a great job. If you ever want to see the scientific response to some of the arguments you see out there, go to Skeptical Science. And he has a link to a presentation I gave at the State Capitol where I sort of went through all the typical skeptic arguments. If you go into the scientific literature, this is the peer-reviewed literature. Science is the most prestigious general science journal in the United States. Nature is the most prestigious general scientific journal in Great Britain. This is the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. If you go into any of these, or if you look at the summaries that come out from the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, you don't see any disagreement about climate change is happening and we're causing it. I'm going to pass around, just to give you an idea of the weight of the evidence, literally. I'm going to pass out one of the volumes. This is actually the 2007 report called Physical Science Basis. This is a 1,000 pages just showing the evidence, just summarizing the evidence. This is summaries of many, many different peer-reviewed scientific studies, and I'll pass that around. There's Dr. James Powell is a geochemist. He got his PhD at MIT. He served on the National Science Board. He was appointed by Ronald Reagan, and then he was reappointed by George Bush to the National Science Board. He's been chairman of a geology department, very prestigious scientist. He just went through all the peer-reviewed scientific journal articles in 2013 and did a search on climate change. And he wanted to find out how many of them basically questioned that mankind is causing climate change. He reviewed 10,885 articles, and he found two. That's basically the ratio he found in 2013. Okay, so maybe some of you accept that climate change is happening, and maybe you accept that we're causing it, but you may say, and I like it warm. I have to admit, I like to go mountain biking, I like to go kayaking. Warm weather is not such a bad thing, right? So why do we think this is a serious problem? And there's sort of a corollary. I mean, maybe you've heard this comment. People say, particularly geologists, people with geologic training, they go, the Earth has gotten warmer, it's gotten colder, you go back millions of years, this is just natural. These variations occur naturally. There's some truth to that, but what's the problem? You have to understand what the relevant time period is. Now, you could say it's gone up and down over millions of years. Is that a relevant time period to us? We'll talk about that in a minute. We know in Colorado, it can be 70 degrees today and 20 degrees tomorrow. Huge change in 24 hours. Is 24 hours a relevant time period? No. What's the relevant time period? This is the relevant time period. This is coming out of the last interglacial period. All right. This is the rise of sea level. This dramatic rise of sea level. Look at this enormous rise in meters. All right. So each one of those meters is a little over 3 feet. This is coming out of the last interglacial, this huge rise of sea level. And then look at this, very constant sea level for about the last 8,000 years. Now, Homo sapiens, us, our species, have been roaming this planet for about 150,000 years. When did we develop civilization? When did we build cities? When did we have agriculture, at river deltas? During this period. It's not a coincidence. Stable sea level. What about temperature? Here we are coming out of that last interglacial. Look at over the last 10,000 years or so. Slight decline due to orbital parameters, but basically within plus or minus a half degree Celsius, very constant temperature. We've had this Goldilocks climate. This is where mankind has developed. This is where we built cities. This is where we developed agriculture. What are we doing to that? This is what we're doing to that. Here's going back now to 500 AD. All right, here's the temperatures. Sure, there's some fluctuations, but look at what we're doing. We're at this point now, and these are the projections. And if you see all these curves, the red one is the one that we're a little bit above now. That says by 2100 will be 5 degrees Celsius. All right? That's like 9 degrees Fahrenheit warmer globally than we are now. That's an enormous change. We're taking ourselves out of that Goldilocks climate. That has sea level consequences, surely. This is an interesting plot because it doesn't just show what scientists think is the most likely sea level rise, it shows probabilities. If you talk to most scientists today, they believe we'll probably have about a meter of sea level rise by 2100, because as the ice sheets melt, they accelerate. So they believe about 3 feet, about 1 meter by 2100. If you look at this plot, the 50% probability point is about 8 tenths of a meter. All right? But look at this. There's a 17% chance it'll be 1.25 meters. There's a 5% chance it'll be nearly 2 meters. Now, no one ever wants to talk about these numbers, but let me ask you this. How many of you have fire insurance on your house? I'm guessing probably most of you, okay? At least I hope you do. And I'm guessing you didn't buy fire insurance because you thought there's a 50-50 chance you're going to have a fire. You bought fire insurance because there's a 1% or 2% chance that there's a fire. Shouldn't we be treating the planet the same way? Aren't those the numbers that we should be looking at to protect the planet? Okay, so let's say, well, forget that, Chuck. I don't buy that argument. Let's look at the 1 meter of sea level rise. Here's Florida today. What are we going to see in 2100? That's Florida at 1 meter of sea level rise. Florida is already experiencing a lot of flooding. Now, you'll say, well, you know, we'll do what the Dutch did. We're going to build seawalls. They're expensive, but you know what? They won't work. Why won't they work? What's that? Exactly. Florida's what's called karst topography. It's all limestone. Okay, limestone's very porous. What happens if you build your seawalls, the sea level comes up, the extra weight of that seawater pushes seawater, salt water, into all the aquifers. You contaminate all the water anyway. It won't work. Florida's got a big problem, a really big problem. Another thing that I think we've seen change a lot in recent years is the understanding that, yes, we're concerned about our children and our grandchildren, but we're already seeing the effects. There's more and more evidence, and again, if you read these articles and they look at the probabilities of events happening with and without climate change, they're showing that these events are occurring with much more regularity and more severity. Heat waves, there were 70,000 people died in the 2003 European heat wave. Drought, look what's happened to California. This is the snowpack in January 13, 2013. This is the snowpack January 13, 2014. Enormous consequences. Coastal flooding, this is Superstorm Sandy. Extreme precipitation, this is a picture of what happened in Boulder, where it just broke all records going back to the 1880s. These events are happening now. This shows you increases over the last 50 years in heavy precipitation events. They're up 71% in the Northeast. These are enormous changes we're seeing today in the environment with just 8/10 of a degree C temperature rise. Those of you who live in Colorado Springs, you know about wildfires. It wasn't bad last year, but the 2 years prior to that, two very, very serious wildfires. This is a statement by the U.S. Forest Service. The wildfire season is now 2 months longer, 2 months longer than it was 40 years ago. The ground is drier, the season is longer. When these fires occur, more of them occur, and when they occur, they're super hot, very hard to put out. My family and I, we like to go on river trips, and have any of you gone down the San Juan River in southeast Utah? A few of you have. This is what's called River House. It's an Anasazi cliff dwelling, dates back to about 1200. The Anasazi migrated out of this, out of the San Juan River Valley. They migrated to the Rio Grande because of a long extended period of drought. They went through a mega drought. A mega drought is a period of drought greater than 35 years. They could stand a drought for a few years, but more than that, they couldn't. They were growing corn. They couldn't get a good crop yield. So mega droughts have occurred in the Southwest. This is a study that just came out in Science Advances, February 12th, right? So this is just like, what, a week ago? They did computer models of what's happening to the climate, and this is the central plains of the U.S. and the Southwest. So if you look at 1950 to 2000, before we had added a lot of greenhouse gas to the atmosphere, basically the chance of a mega drought was about 15%. Not negligible, they can occur. If you look at 2050 to 2099, if you look at the latter half of this century with what we're doing to the atmosphere, this is what the computer models show. About an 80% probability of droughts of 35 years or longer. These are devastating droughts. This is what's going to happen if we keep emitting carbon dioxide the way we are. There are a lot of explanations for why we're getting this extreme weather. Most of the explanations center on the fact that we've had what's called Arctic amplification. For reasons that I won't go into here, the Arctic has warmed quite a bit more than the rest of the planet, maybe about 5 degrees Fahrenheit. And so the temperature difference between the Arctic and the equator, that temperature difference tends to drive weather patterns. And we've decreased that temperature difference. So there's various effects that occur, and also we've lost a lot of sea ice in the summer. That has impacts also. This is Jennifer Francis. She's an atmospheric scientist at Rutgers. She has a theory that's somewhat controversial. Scientists do debate stuff, okay? They don't debate whether climate change is happening. They don't debate whether we're causing it. They do debate why we're seeing all these extreme weather events. Her theory is this. The jet stream is a river of a fluid. In this case, not water, air, okay? Now, if you think of a river of water, when a river comes out of the mountains, as it's going down the slope, it flows very fast, and it flows more or less down the fall line. What happens to a river when it loses all that gravitational force and it hits a flat plain? What does it do? It's, It slows down and it meanders. You know, you ever spill milk on the kitchen floor and you just see it go whack and forth, okay? Her argument is that because this temperature differential has gone down so far, the jet stream is slowing. It's going into these big swooping meanders, okay? And it's getting stuck in those meanders. And if you look at what's been happening, where we get these big swoops of the jet stream, we get all this cold air moving down in the east, and then the west, we get stuck with this very dry drought conditions, and it gets stuck in these patterns for long periods. That's our theory for what's going on. I want to say a little bit about the ocean. This is NOAA's coral bleaching forecast for February through May of this year. Because of very high sea surface temperatures, we're going to see major coral bleaching events. So anything in the red here is alert level. Another thing that we're seeing is when carbon dioxide gets too high in the atmosphere, it equilibrates somewhat with the ocean. So CO2 gets dissolved in the ocean. And when it does, it combines with water to form what's called carbonic acid. And so here's a plot of what's happening to the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. Here's a plot of what's happening to the carbon dioxide in the ocean. It's following that. And here's the pH. The pH, of course, if you remember from your high school chemistry, the pH is a measure of acidity. The lower the pH, the more acid. The pH has dropped about a tenth of a point. It's a log scale, so that's big, all right? That means oceans are about 26 to 30% more acidic than they were before. This has huge implications for various types of sea life that are built on calcium carbonate, like fossils, okay? That's a picture of my son. This is a picture I took back when he was 12 years old. He's 22 years old now. This is when we were snorkeling in the Virgin Islands. We had wonderful coral down there. Major bleaching event just two years later that really destroyed a lot of the coral, particularly in the US Virgin Islands. All right, so I'm telling you climate change is serious. But maybe you don't believe me. I'm just one guy. Who else thinks climate change is a serious problem? So let me ask a question. Which branch of the federal government takes climate change most seriously? Exactly. Department of Defense. These are recent reports. A military advisory board that has about 15 generals on it. The Department of Defense climate change adaptation report. These are just two reports in the last 2 years. The one on the left, they had done a report 7 years ago, and they specifically said in this report, it's way worse than they thought it was 7 years ago. These are quotes, the national security risks of projected climate change are as serious as any challenges we have faced. The days of climate change as a future concern are over. I think this is rather interesting. There's an article in the current issue of Rolling Stone magazine by the writer Jeff Goodell. He wrote the book Big Coal, but in recent years he's been writing a lot about climate change. And it's all about how the Pentagon is reacting to climate change. This is a Department of the Navy website. It's the Navy Task Force Energy website. And this is basically them promoting people, read this article in Rolling Stone magazine. I don't know how often a Navy website has told people go read Rolling Stone, but that's what's happening here. That's what's on their website this week. This was a 2011 study done by the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. And basically, back in 2011, they concluded human-caused climate change was a major factor in the fact that we're seeing much more frequent and serious Mediterranean droughts. 2011. Now, I'm going to turn your attention to where the country with the most red in it on this, that's where the drought is the worst. And that's this country right in here. Who's good in geography? Israel. Not Israel. Syria. That's Syria. What happened in Syria? Extended drought conditions, just like they said in this 2011 report. Crops were failing. People living off farms moved into the cities. They couldn't find work. There became a lot of unrest. The government couldn't do anything to help them. All right? Certainly, I'm not saying that all the Syrian unrest was caused by climate change, but a lot of people who studied it believe this drought was a major factor in what's happening in Syria, and Syria is now the center of where ISIL is. So you could see why the military is concerned. My son, who majored in history, tells me that foreign policy is a very highly respected journal on history and foreign policy. And I just discovered they did a survey of the America's top international relations scholars. One of the things they had to ask these people was, who is the best Secretary of State? Okay? Their responses, number one, Henry Kissinger. All right? Number two, James Baker. So if you think these are a bunch of liberal college professors, think again. They also asked him what they think of the most important thing we should be worried about right now. This is this week now. This just came out. What are the three most important foreign policy issues facing the United States today? Look at the top of the list. Global climate change. Look at the number, 40.96%. Second place, armed conflict in the Middle East is not even close. This is what the foreign policy experts are saying. So you say, wait a minute. You're telling me it's happening, we're causing it, it's serious. Why aren't we taking it seriously? Why aren't we doing more about it? This is a poll by a company out of Paris called Ipsos. And they basically make statements and they ask you to whether you agree or disagree or don't know. And one of the statements was, climate change is caused by humans. Chinese believe it is. Let's look at the three countries that believe that the least. Australia, Great Britain, and who's the winner at the bottom? Us, the United States. Now, we can spend a lot of time speculating, why is it? Why is there so much disbelief in the United States? But look at these three countries. They're all English speaking. Can anybody think of something else that unites those three countries? Bingo. Bingo. Rupert Murdoch controls major media in all three of these countries. And I don't care whether you watch Fox News or you read the Wall Street Journal, you pick up any issue of the Wall Street Journal, you're going to find articles about what a bunch of phooey climate change is. And the people in Australia and Great Britain are reading the same stuff. And those people are at the bottom of the list. Information matters. But what about all those greedy scientists, right? Haven't you heard? It's just those greedy climate scientists. They're after research dollars, right? They went through their whole college careers in graduate school in science, but now they're just concerned about money, all right? They're willing to put their careers at stake and come out with all these crazy climate change articles just to make money. Follow the money. Where does it lead you? This is the U.S. climate change annual research budget, $2 billion. That's a lot of money, isn't it? Here's one oil company, ExxonMobil, the average annual revenue, $420 billion. Their profits are about 10%, $40 billion profit, one oil company. The profit of one oil company is 20 times the entire US federal budget to study climate science. So if you think you're following the money and you're coming upon greedy climate scientists, I ask you to think again. This is an article that appeared in Scientific American, Dark Money Funds Climate Change Denial Effort. A lot of oil companies said, you know what, we're not going to fund the climate change denial thing anymore. We're on board. You know, we're not going to, you know, object to the science anymore. And so a professor at Drexel University got IRS records, and he wanted to see where money was really going. His conclusion in a peer-reviewed journal article on climatic change, January of 2013, 140 foundations, some of the very legitimate foundations, like Annenberg, funneled $558 million to almost 100 climate denial organizations from 2003 to 2010. I'm going to show you the next slide. I'm going to violate a rule. When I go up and I give talks at the University of Colorado, I tell students there how to give good slides. I tell them, you know, don't put 50 word bullets on a slide. Make sure your slides are readable. All right? So I'm going to violate my rule here. Because what I'm going to show you, and this is from the article, that the paper that Robert Bruhl did, he laid out the spider web of how all this money flows to these organizations, and that's it. That's how this money gets to organizations that tell you that climate change is a bunch of baloney. This is in the paper, what, 3 days ago. This is Willie Soon. He's one of the people that really came out against Michael Mann's so-called hockey stick curve that shows that when we started burning fossil fuels, the temperature went way up. Oh, no, no, it was much warmer in the global war, in the medieval warming period. Basically, people have uncovered evidence that he's gotten $1.25 million from the fossil fuel industry. Not only that, he signed contracts with them, and his deliverables were to write papers denying climate change and to give talks denying climate change. On top of that, any serious scientist that looks at his work basically finds it very, very flawed. Naomi Oreskes and her colleague Eric Conway, Naomi, when she wrote this book, was at the University of California, San Diego. She's now a professor at Harvard. It's called Merchants of Doubt. It really gives you an explanation of how all this information gets disseminated and why. It's a good book if you have a chance to read it. If you don't have a chance to read a whole book, all of us are pretty busy, what I'd recommend instead is get this month's National Geographic magazine. National Geographic's done a great job of covering energy and climate change. This is this month's issue. I just got it in my mailbox about 4 days ago. The War on Science. And it really talks about how can it be that people don't get science? And part of it is all of us, I include myself, we all hang around with certain groups of people that kind of agree with us. And if you raise your hand and say, wait a minute, I'm starting to have second thoughts about this climate change thing. Maybe these scientists are onto something. All of a sudden, your friends are going to go like this, OK? We're all, all more or less under some peer pressure to believe a certain set of beliefs. And it's not easy to step out of that. And this article refers to some interesting research that was done that examines that phenomenon. But it's a really good article, and I recommend you read it. And it talks about autism. And it talks about vaccines in addition to climate change. But a good portion of the article is about climate change. OK, I'm going to finish the climate change with another Onion headline. New climate change study, just 400 pages of scientists telling Americans to read previous climate change studies. That's really what it's about. I mean, you know, the Onion's funny, but whenever they say something, it's basically 95% true. The good news, change is afoot. Of course, there was a big march in New York City, depending on, it's always hard to do crowd estimates, but somewhere between 300,000 and 400,000 people. I wasn't there, but proud to say a niece of mine participated who works in New York City. That was back in September 21st, protesting for climate change action. This is just out, I have a date on here, February 13th, again, just about a week ago. While US politicians argue about climate change, British politicians decide the debate is over. So the British politicians have finally said, OK, let's stop arguing about this. We admit it. We're causing it. It's happening. Wouldn't it be nice if that happened in this country? World's biggest PR firm, Edelman, calls it quits with American oil lobby. And again, this is I don't have the date on here, but this was just in the last week, I think. British Petroleum, now they call themselves BP, says CO2 emissions unsustainable, warns on global warming. This is news as of February 17th. There's a big change going on. People are finally saying they don't want to be on the wrong side of history. All right, part three, what can we do about it? This is the good news part. So I've got 20 minutes left. I'm going to give you kind of a whirlwind tour here. What's the goal? I mentioned before, look, you hear about we got to keep temperature below 2 degrees C. That's only because people think we probably can't do any better than that, not because they think it's going to solve our problems. We're going to have to adapt. We're already past the point of no return on climate change. But the more CO2 we put in the atmosphere, the worse the consequences. What we really need to do is get to zero as rapidly as humanly possible. That can cause a lot of disruption. You have to be careful. I mean, obviously, you don't want people out of work. It's great if people are making wind turbines, but you've got to figure out how do we retrain people, et cetera. So these are the various carbon-free options. If we keep burning fossil fuels, we need to capture and sequester the carbon. And studies have shown you can geologically sequester carbon dioxide. But it's not cheap to capture that carbon. Nuclear power, very legitimate. Recent studies show that orders for new nuclear power plants wind up being very expensive. So probably the biggest hurdle that nuclear has, I mean, I think that can be built safely. There are new designs where you're not so much worried about the waste. But getting the cost of nuclear down is a challenge. I'm covering the last two because this is the area I work in. All right, I got a master's in nuclear engineering back in the 70s, but for the last 38 years of my career, I've been working in efficiency and renewable energy. And so I led this study for the American Solar Energy Society. It's called Tackling Climate Change in the U.S., and I'll pass it around, but I'm going to show you some results of that. So this is the report I'm passing around. It's about a 200-page report. What we did is we asked experts in each of these areas to do a bottoms-up estimate of what they thought they could do by the year 2030 to reduce U.S. carbon emissions. What can your technology do to reduce emissions? And so there's efficiency, and then all these different types of energy, and I'm going to quickly summarize them. As you'll see in a chart I show you later, the big thing is energy efficiency. You've heard stories that huge potential. Those stories are right. Huge potential and very cost effective. So about 40% of our energy gets used in buildings. This is an area that my center focuses on. About 3/4 of United States electricity is consumed in buildings. So buildings is really important. Transportation is about 30%, industry another 30%. Talking about buildings, it's estimated that between now and 2030, over the next 15 years, new and rebuilt floor space in buildings, buildings are usually measured in terms of total floor area, okay? 900 billion square feet will be built over the next 15 years. That's 3.5 times the total building area in the United States right now. That's an enormous amount of building. Most of that's going to be in China and India. And the point is, if we don't build those buildings right, we're in trouble. They have to be built with super energy efficiency. Here's an example. This is the office building I work in. This is the research support facility at the National Renewable Energy Laboratory in Golden. It's got three wings. These are two wings. That's the C wing. That's the B wing. All the top management are in the A wing. They had to make sure their wing was called the A wing and not the C wing. You can only see about half the wing here because it goes on the other side. But these wings are oriented east-west, okay? And so there's lots of south-facing glass. And so if you look in these buildings, you see tremendous amount of daylighting. We have what are called light louvers on the windows that reflect sunlight up onto the white ceiling. And so because it's not very deep in this direction, the whole area gets illuminated by light. So daylighting reduces the lighting load, the electricity used for lighting. It also reduces the cooling load, and it provides passive solar heating in the wintertime. I could spend, if I have a separate presentation, I could spend an hour talking about all the features of this building. It's incredible, okay? But I do want to point out just one thing, and that is, as an example, even the workstations are very energy efficient. Instead of a typical workstation using 400 watts, our typical one uses 70 watts. Except I noticed a guy in my group, I looked at something on his desk today, and it was a little coffee warmer, and he wasn't going to show that to me, but I happened to discover it. But anyway, very efficient. The way this got pulled off, you know, I've been at NREL for 36 years, and many, many times we'd build a building on campus, and we'd go, oh, you know, we want to be involved in that. And the architects would say, yeah, we're going to have a design charrette, and we're going to put, you know, things up on the wall, and we want to hear all your ideas. And we have all these great ideas, you know. And then they start building the building, and they go, yeah, we were going to have that attached greenhouse, but, you know, it broke the budget. We dropped that, and we had to drop this one. And by the time they get done, none of our features are in there. This building, the RSF, energy performance was built into the contract at the beginning, and the financial incentives were built into the contract. If it wasn't energy efficient, they didn't get paid. Guess what? They figured out how to do it, okay? This is what the Obama administration came out with, new CAFE, Corporate Average Fuel Economy Standards for Vehicles. This is what they were from 1980 to 2010, 2009, whatever that number is there. This is an enormous improvement in energy efficiency of cars. This is going to have a big effect. Talk about photovoltaics. So photovoltaics are a way, right, to convert sunlight directly to electricity. They're called PV or photovoltaic panels. They can be used on roofs, or they can be used on separated out on the ground. This is the campus where I work. And you can see there's over 3 megawatts of total photovoltaics spread throughout the campus. There's photovoltaics on the top of the office building I work in, all right? But that's not enough to power the whole building. We actually have to pull off this visitor park parking lot and off the main parking lot to make this what's called a net zero building, where basically we generate enough renewable energy to make up for all the energy the building uses over a year, okay? This is what we have on the Mesa top. Utilities are now putting some of these systems in, central systems. So these are actually, they aim east in the morning and they track in a single axis and follow the sun throughout the day. This is the kind of system that utilities favor because it's in their business model, right? What did utilities do for years? They built coal plants and they sent you electricity over the transmission lines. That's how they want to do it. They're not real keen on you putting photovoltaics on your rooftop. Have any of you seen the XL Responsible Solar campaign? Did you wonder what that means? This is responsible. The stuff on your rooftop, not so responsible. Okay. So what's happening is solar has gotten so inexpensive, I'll show you that in a minute, that it's that utilities and others are starting to react. Fortunately, some utilities are adopting it. XL, to its credit, is doing central, but could be a little bit faster, I would say, supporting rooftop. Germany sets solar record. There are various times during the day where it's met half its electric demand from all the solar PV it's installed. And the German economy, by the way, is booming. You might have read stories in the Wall Street Journal that Germany did all this wind and solar, and now they're hurting economically. They're doing very well economically. But according to Fox News, how'd they do it? They did it because they have a much better solar resource in the United States, according to a reporter on Fox News. Here's the solar resource in the US, there's the solar resource in Germany. Germany has a solar resource that's about the same as what we have in Alaska. Okay? So imagine, as we adopt more and more photovoltaics, what we could do in this country. This is the cost of photovoltaics. You probably heard of the Moore effect for the cost of semiconductors, how rapidly it comes down. They call that the Swanson effect for PV, that for every doubling of shipments, there's a 20% reduction in PV. So it used to be as much as over $70 a watt. Now it's 70 cents a watt. These are enormous drops in cost. The Chinese have driven a lot of this. We'll talk about China later. This is PV installations growing dramatically. Utility scale, residential in the red, and then non-residential systems. You've probably heard of Tesla and Elon Musk. These are Tesla vehicles. This is a solar city on a rooftop. The idea is you get a system from Solar City, you don't buy it, you basically lease it, and you would just immediately see a savings on your electric bill. They're bearing the capital costs of the system. Eventually, we can reach a point where your PV systems are charging your vehicles. SolarCity is now marketing battery storage to go with these systems so that you're not necessarily completely tied to the grid all the time. And they develop superchargers that'll charge your car in 20 minutes, being spread all over the country. This is a very exciting time for the energy field. After 100 years of nothing much changing, all of a sudden, stuff is changing like crazy. And anyone who's an engineer or a scientist that gets into the energy field, wow. This is really exciting time to be a young engineer or scientist getting into this field. Sometimes I spend more time on this. I'm only going to mention the grid integration issue. And the grid integration issue is that wind and photovoltaics are variable. And so the utility has to make sure they're providing steady, reliable power. We have this whole energy systems integration facility that's designed to study that issue. Another area I work in is concentrating solar power. This works like a coal plant. Instead of burning coal to produce steam and spin a steam turbine that spins a generator, you concentrate solar energy with these parabolic troughs. You heat an oil to a very high temperature. You transfer that heat to water. You boil the water. You produce steam. So on the plant side, it looks just like a coal plant. You're running a steam turbine. These were installed in the 1980s. For 20 years, they've been providing reliable electricity, 350 megawatts, to the Southern California grid. This is a mature technology. This is a picture a colleague took of me on the top of Tower 3 at the Ivanpah Towers that just came online in the last few months. I'm on the top of Tower 3. This was last October. This was the very day the Tower 1 synchronized to the California grid. You can see it lit up there. Now you have mirrors focusing on a boiler at the top of a tower producing steam and running a steam turbine. This is 392 megawatts, all these three towers put together. A coal plant might be 500 megawatts. Nuclear plant might be 1,000 megawatts. Those are really big plants. This is a sizable plant. But the big attraction is storage, and that is that if you can store the power, and what we do here is we store it in hot molten salt. So basically, you oversize your collector field, whether it's a tower or troughs. You heat molten salt during the day as you're generating power. After the sun sets, you can continue to use that hot fluid to boil water to produce steam to run a turbine. So this is the Solana plant. This is while it was still under construction. It's operating now. It was built by Arizona Public Service, and it provides 250 megawatts of power to Phoenix. And it's got 6 hours of storage, so it'll keep providing electricity for 6 hours after the sunset, of course, which is very important in the evening in Phoenix, if you've ever been to Phoenix. Wind power has taken off in this country. You can see the bands of where wind power is. Turbines have gotten really, really big. That's really lowered the cost. And they found when they make them really, really big, if they didn't put them on a high tower, the blades get stuck in the ground. So, okay, that's a stupid joke. Actually, the reason they build them bigger was they want to get up into these higher wind regimes. They're getting out of what's called the boundary layer. So these things are performing real well. But we have so many wind farms now, what's happening is they can interfere with each other. And look at this. This is a picture in the North Sea. The wind happened to be going in this particular direction where these downwind turbines are really influenced by the ones up. You're seeing water, actually water vapor in the atmosphere here as it sort of condenses out when the pressure drops. So that's something that we're really studying now is how do you optimize these wind farms and account for these turbine-to-turbine effects. There's world wind power, over 300,000 megawatts. In the US now, we have over 60,000 megawatts. Huge success story. And it's a way for farmers to make money off their land. They can might get like $5,000 per turbine on their land. They can still farm the land right around the turbines, but they'll take that extra $5,000 per turbine. Thank you very much. Biomass and biofuels, I'm not going to say much about this. You can burn biomass and produce power like you would coal. Biofuels, of course, for vehicles or airplanes, jets. But I want to point out that something that's called bioenergy with carbon capture and storage. Conventional biomass power is what's called carbon neutral. In fact, all the renewables are carbon neutral. They don't pull carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere. They just don't produce carbon dioxide. So they're considered carbon neutral, unlike fossil fuels, which add carbon, right? So what happens in biomass is you grow plants. The plants suck carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere. You burn and produce power, and it puts CO2 back in. So it's carbon neutral. Now, the coal industry has looked at carbon capture and storage. Let's take that carbon dioxide out of coal and let's store it geologically. What if you do that with biomass? Now you're carbon negative. So the plants take the carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere, but you extract the carbon dioxide and geologically sequester it, and you just use the hydrogen, which is clean burning, to produce power. So of all the renewables, bio can be actually carbon negative. And the last thing is geothermal. This is a power plant that I've actually done some work at. This is in Mammoth Lakes, Northern California, a power plant. Basically, we've almost tapped out the easy geothermal. That's the hot water and steam near the surface. There's about 3,000 megawatts of geothermal plants in the US, and they all use that. If we really want to get big, you got to dig real deep, get to what's called hot dry rock, inject water down there, produce hot water, bring it to the surface. There's a lot of risk associated with that. It's not easy. It can be expensive. But when you do it, a geothermal plant provides nice, steady power 24 hours a day, rain or shine. And the US Geological Survey estimated at the 50% confidence level that if you did this, you could provide up to 500,000 megawatts in the US. That's half our total grid power. So this is why, even though it's a high-risk approach, it's worth pursuing. It's carbon neutral. So if you look at all these things, this is how they would show up on a map. You know, you have concentrating solar power and geothermal in the west. You have in the southeast and northeast and midwest and the northwest, you have biomass, et cetera. And if you put all these things together, all these things together with efficiency can get you in the range of a 60 to 80% reduction in carbon dioxide emissions by the year 2050. This is how it looks like on a wedges chart. This is all the efficiency. This is how the carbon dioxide would grow out to 2030. This is what efficiency would do, more or less levelize it out even as your economy grows. And then each of these wedges, there's wind, there's biofuels, there's biomass, all these different wedges are those different renewable wedges. What does that cost? If you added all these renewable wedges together, the net cost would be about $26 billion a year. We were spending that about every 2 months in the Iraq war. So that's not necessarily an outrageous amount of money. But that wedge of efficiency would save $100 billion a year. If you deploy all this together, you'd actually be saving the economy $82 billion a year. A study was done, if we did that, how many jobs would be created? It would create 4.5 million, not jobs, but net jobs. A lot of people talk about the cost of addressing climate change. What's the cost of not addressing climate change? This is a study done by Tufts University in 2008. They estimated that by the year 2025, cleaning up all the damage from climate change, we're only talking 10 years from now, will cost the US economy $250 billion a year. Climate change, most studies show that cleaning up the damage from climate change is at least 10 times as expensive as preventing it, as mitigating it. So when people say we can't afford to address climate change, my response is, actually, we can't afford not to, economically. I want to finish by talking about the China deal, right? President Obama signed this deal with China. It was a real bad deal for the US, right? Let's look at that. So here's the deal, and the deal basically said that basically by 2030, we're going to reduce our carbon emissions by, I think, 26% below 2005 levels, and that China is going to peak its carbon emissions by 2030, and by 2030 provide 20% of its energy from renewables. So the reaction was, wait a minute, we have to start reducing carbon dioxide emissions. They get to 2030. They can keep building up to 2030. Sounds like a bad deal, right? Let's look at that a little bit more closely. First of all, what really matters about climate change is not how much we're emitting now, it's how much has gone into the atmosphere. That determines the greenhouse gases. This shows you the amount the US is responsible for and the amount China is responsible for. We're responsible about 2.5 times as much as China is. Here's another thing. I'm going to date myself here, but I'm old enough to remember that when I went to Walmart, I would find only things made in the United States. Does anybody remember that? American made in Walmart? Go into Walmart tomorrow, try to find something that's not manufactured in China. So what's happened is, if you look at those Chinese coal plants and the emissions, how dare they? But where are they? Where are those products going to? This is how much is going to the US, this is how much is going to Europe. We've outsourced our carbon emissions. This shows you the China path that continue to grow. This shows you what we've agreed to. But look, we've agreed to get to this point, but this is what we've been doing lately. What the president agreed to is to more or less stay on the path we're on. In fact, it's a little bit higher than what we've been on. Pretty smart, actually. What about China? So China's agreed to levelize out by 2030. But here's the path they're on now. They're not going to be on this path till they get to 2030 and then bang, peak. If you want to peak at 2030, you got to start now. So to really peak at 2030, they've got to be on this path. They need to immediately slow their growth of carbon emissions. This is a big challenge for China. China is the biggest user of wind power in the world, ahead of the United States. In fact, their total energy produced from wind power, electrical energy produced, passed nuclear in China. They're now producing more energy from wind than they are from nuclear power. China is the emerging world renewable energy economic powerhouse, all right? This is the, it's expected that next, right now they're the biggest producer of PV, photovoltaic panels in the world. They were invented in the US. China is the world's biggest producer. They're making money off those panels. In 2016, they will surpass the US as the biggest producer of wind turbines. They're making money off this new energy. They're smart. They have more solar hot water heaters than any country in the world. Okay, so I'm just going to finish. You've probably seen this quote before, but I think it has a lot of relevance. We don't inherit the earth from our ancestors. We borrow it from our children. We're the stewards of this planet. And our kids and our grandkids, they're inheriting what we give them. And so I don't want to be in an old folks' home, and I don't want my son or I don't want my grandson to say, hey, granddad, what were you doing? And I really want to say more than I was out giving slide presentations, okay? Okay, so that's it. Now, I'm going to finish. I think I have enough time. I'm going to show something. How many of you have seen the movie Chasing Ice? Oh, pretty good, actually. That's quite good. Maybe about 20% of you. If the 20% will bear with me, for those who haven't seen it, I want to show the big calving event in that film. It occurs near the end of the film, and let me set it up. So James Balog is a National Geographic photographer lives in Boulder, and he did many stories on redwood trees and wildlife, and he's a great photographer. He's been involved in National Geographic for a long time. About 8 years ago, he had a story to do in the Arctic. And like a lot of people who go up to the Arctic, he basically had the reaction, oh my God, I can't believe what these people are showing me. And for the last 8 years, he's dedicated his life to putting Nikon cameras all over the place to do time-lapse photography and record what's going on. At DIA, have you seen those films by the train station? Those are all from Jim Balog, okay? One of the things he did, so this movie Chasing Ice is basically his story. It's a great documentary. I highly recommend it. You can get it on Netflix or iTunes. But one of the things he's done is he's also done some video photography. And he was having really bad problems with his knees. He just recently had knee replacements. But he sent some of his students out, and they camped out over the Jakobshavn Glacier, which is the biggest outflow glacier on the west coast of Greenland. And they were there for several weeks waiting to try to hopefully capture on film a glacier calving event. They were within a day or two of saying, forget it, you know, we're out of food, we're getting out of here. And this is what happened.
Up to the covered with icebergs so thick that you could walk across the ocean and never touch it.
I'm on the phone with Jim on one of our regular check-ins. Jim, just nothing's happening.
Hey, Jim. It's going well. We had some serious bouts of wind. But other than that, things are fairly well set up here. We've got some continuous time lapse going.
It's starting, Adam, I think. Adam, it's starting.
Oh, wait, Jim. Jim, this is the big piece is starting to cast.
Let me call you back.
Call him back.
Okay, bye.
Still going?
Yeah, in that V section right there. Holy shit, look at that big bird rolling. All four are running, right?
Yeah.
Look at that.
You see how, look at the whole thing.
Thank you.
faces 300, sometimes 400 feet tall. Pieces of ice were shooting up out of the ocean 600 feet and then falling. The only way that you can really try to put it into scale with human reference is if you imagine Manhattan. And all of a sudden, all of those buildings just start to rumble and quake and peel off and just fall over and roll around. This whole massive city just breaking apart in front of your eyes. We're just observers, these two little dots on the side of the mountain. And we watched and recorded the largest witness calving event ever caught on tape.
So how big was this calving event that we just looked at? We'll resort to some illustrations again to give you a sense of scale. It's as if the entire lower tip of Manhattan broke off, except that the thickness, the height of it, is equivalent to buildings that are 2.5 or 3 times higher than they are. A magical, miraculous, horrible, scary thing. I don't know that anybody's really seen the miracle and horror of that. It took 100 years for it to retreat 8 miles from 1900 to 2000. From 2000 to 2010, it retreated 9 miles. So in 10 years, it retreated more than it had in the previous 100.
Okay. That's what I have. Thanks very much for listening. We'll have a question and answer period now.